Welcome, friends, to this afternoon session of our monthly meeting. You will see I've come properly dressed now. My friend, is that Guru? Here he is. He has come all the way from Istanbul, Turkey, to make sure I wear a proper tie. I'm very happy to welcome him. He has his meeting me, and his story is very, very touching for me. He had a beautiful daughter who went for some trip with some other girls, and there was a plane crash and they all died. She died also. Her name was Jasmine. And my friend and his wife and the girl's sister were very fond of her. She's a beautiful soul. And by some strange set of coincidences, he was able to reach me after reaching a few other people who gave some information to him about what happens when a person dies. I was very happy that he came to me, because when he said that, "Can I find a person who died?" I said, "I can't find, I'm an ordinary person, but my master can. Great master, Baba Savan Singh can. And fortunately, being his initiate, I have contact with him." He said, "Can you request your master to see if she can find?" And fortunately, great master, when I approached him, in his radiant astral form, he was able to locate the disembodied form of the daughter at the site of the accident. And when I saw and he saw what her future was going to be like, to be tied up there for a long time, we made a request to help her. Now I'm very happy that Jasmine is at the causal plane and trying to help a lot of other people. So I've been following up on this with this, and this was one of the strange examples. Many people come like that, and they don't realize that when we die, the astral self does not die. It has a much longer life and remains in a disembodied state, especially if the death is unnatural. That means it is not a natural process by which a notional life is set up in the physical plane, but it's an unnatural death. One can stay in that state of disembodied form for a long time. So this was a very special grace that my master did, and I am very impressed by my master's power and what he can do. And he has shown me that power in many other cases also. I'm very happy to welcome Izzet Baru here today. And I'm also happy that he's told me to be better well-dressed. thank you, Izzet. I mentioned to you in the morning that a lot of people ask me, how do we know who's a perfect master? How do we know you are a master? I said, about me, I can say straight away, I'm not a master. That is simple enough. About others, I cannot comment, because that is not my role. I am very lucky to be a disciple of a perfect living master who proved his perfection as a living master by letting me have the experiences which he promised. When he promised this can happen and it happened, I am satisfied completely, 100%. So I can talk about him as a perfect living master and tell you everything about him. About other masters, I cannot make any comment. It's not my role. But based upon the teachings of the great master, I can tell you a few things about perfect living masters. Firstly, they never say they are a master. They are always saying, we are the servants of the people whom we serve, and we are the servants of our own masters. They always give credit to their own master for everything that happens. even though we see them doing everything. All the miracles I saw in Baba Sawan Singh. But when I talked to him, he would say his master, Baba Jamal Singh, is doing everything. So that is a sign. Masters never claim that they are masters. Why? They don't have to. They have not come here to establish something or to claim something. They have come to pick up the marked souls who they consider are ready to go back to their true home, and they take them to their true home without any doubt about it. They don't judge. They have no judgment. If a human being claims to be a master and is judging people, you are good, you are not good, he cannot be a perfect living master. They are completely free of judgment, and they love everybody without exception. There's nobody they can say they hate. If they are perfect living masters, they see themselves as part of everybody. They know that their consciousness has gone to a point where they can see everybody is part of the same. Not by a concept, but by an experience. So therefore, they love everybody. And they love unconditionally. That means there is no condition attached. If you do this, then we will love you. No matter what you do, they will love you. If you love them, they love you. If you don't love them, they love you. If you hate them, they love you. If you kill them, they love you. That's the type of love these perfect living masters have. And their love comes from them just by being in their company. We get affected by it. There is something in their way of dealing with disciples that we all feel some closeness. And they can make us feel that closeness even without saying a single word. They are not teachers. They don't come to teach us anything. They know there are millions of teachers available. What they teach by way of meditation or description of what is inside, what are these different levels that we are going through of consciousness, what the bodies are, all these are in the books. Thousands of books in every language is available today. That knowledge is all available everywhere. They don't come to teach that at all. But since our minds like to be taught, so temporarily they become our teachers. Temporarily. Till we discover who they are. They are lovers of unconditional love. They love us because we are marked to go with that master. It's a very beautiful setup here. When you come to know the ultimate truth, you discover the ultimate truth is just a universal, total consciousness, one. Even one is the wrong word, because the moment I say one, you can think of many. Total. I don't even know if total is correct. There is no language that I know to describe the ultimate source, that there is nothing apart from that. We are saying we are going to go there. But do you know here is also there? Because if here is not there, then that is not total. If we are not there, that is not total. This is a very difficult concept because we have separated ourselves. Our mind has separated ourselves from the truth and from what the reality is. And it cannot appreciate the reality because it continues to assert the individuation that has taken place for the sake of a certain experience. That is why these masters, they see from a very different point of view. Therefore, their love is imminent, automatic, even as human beings, because their consciousness is at that level. Unlike many other enlightened people who get strange experiences, and then they come back to tell us about their experience, perfect living masters have that experience continuously 24/7. When they speak to us, they are speaking from what they are experiencing when they are speaking, not from memory of what they experienced at one time. That is why their speech is forceful. Their speech is forceful and they declare what they have to declare with no uncertainty. You will never find in the talks of great master any maybes or perhapses. Maybe it could be like that, perhaps. Those are professors. They do that. But not the masters. So the masters speak with authority. I remember when I, again, referring to the Bible, which impressed me a lot. I was baptized once at one time because I was searching for every religion. I was converted to Islam. I was baptized into Catholic Christianity. I was into other kind of Hinduism. I was into many yogic practices. I did everything to find out if he is right or wrong, to find out if there's something better than what he is giving. And I did it because he said so. At the time of initiation, he said, I was so young, he said, if you can find something better, take it. And he said, do me one favor. If you find something better than what I'm giving you, please come and tell me, I will also take it. That was great master. So open. That affected me, that he's so open. He says, there's no binding. We are not binding you down. If a master binds you down, and you feel afraid to leave him, that's not a perfect living master. They're the leader of a cult. These cults work on fear. Masters work on love and not on fear. With perfect living masters, you always have experience of love, no fear. Whereas these cults, they bind you down and people are afraid to leave. Something will happen. We'll get killed. They'll go after us. That is never the case with a perfect living master. So that is why I searched for all this. When I saw the Sermon on the Mount by Jesus Christ, gave a good sermon. And at the end it said, after he spake, there was a hush upon the multitude. For he spake like one with authority and not like the scribes. That's a very big difference. When a learned man speaks, he speaks differently than a man with authority speaks. Perfect living masters speak with authority because they're speaking directly from what they're experiencing when they're speaking. A very big difference. So when you find any of these things missing, secondly, they never come to get money out of you for their teaching. All the masters, they work for their living. And even historically, we look at the history of some Indian famous people who were masters. Kabir, we sing his praises even today, recite his verses everywhere. He was a weaver of cloth. His patrons, his customers were very rich. They said, why are you weaving? You come and stay with us. We'll give you a big house. He said, no. By destiny, as a human being, I've come with a destiny and I have an obligation to be a weaver. I'll remain a weaver. Ravidas was a cobbler, mending shoes, making shoes, repairing shoes. And his shoe shop was outside the palace of a king. And the king became his follower. And would say to him many times, Master, why do you work on the shoes? All night you work for your customers. Why don't you come up and stay in our palace? We'll give you a whole grand new suite to live in. He said, no, I have come destined to be cobbler. The fact I have an awareness of what all is happening does not change a small role I have to perform. He says, supposing you have a role to perform on a stage, in a stage show, in a drama, and the role you have been given is not the best that you can think of, you still perform the same role. You don't want to upset the whole show. This is a show. We are all wearing costumes. These are our costumes. We are performing our roles. And the script has been written so beautifully. It's not written in ink. It is written in the language of thought. So therefore, when we think and we decide, I think I should do this, we think we are doing something new. We are merely acting on the script. the script works through the mind. And that is why when we say everything is pre-written, people say, no, I can change it. When they say I can change it, it's part of the script. That's what they're supposed to say. The whole thinking process, the whole logic that we are using is prescripted. So that is why we can't understand how it is all made up. What is made up is prescripted. The way we think and imagine and do things, they're all prescripted. So that is why we are on a show. Now when an actor feels, I am merely an actor, he won't be a good actor. When he believes he is really the part, playing the part, he is that, he'll play the role much better. There was a movie made called Gandhi. Ben Kingsley, a British actor, acted as the Indian Gandhi, the Indian leader Gandhi. With makeup and all that, they made him look like Gandhi. But he refused to get the movie shot. He said, wait, every morning I should wake up and feel I am Gandhi. He delayed the shooting. He said himself in an interview in New Delhi, he said, I delayed the shooting till I began to really feel I am Gandhi. Then I said, now shoot. A great movie. Made a great movie. He did a great acting. So good actors are those who really think that they are really who they are wearing the costume of. We are the best actors, all of us, because we really think that this is ourselves. And we do not know. We have been shut off from that awareness to make us continue to be good actors. So we act so well. A perfect living master also puts on a cloak, but he keeps his awareness intact. Therefore, when he gets the awareness intact, he is able to see it's a show. He has to play his role, cobbler, weaver, whatever. And he does his own role, performs, and does not make the sharing of spiritual awareness and spiritual guidance a part of his money-making, of his earning. To make it sure that he's a giver, not a taker. He doesn't come to take, he comes to give. As you will see, now when you find people are collecting money, then charging fees for giving initiations, then charging fees for even giving, listening to their talks, not a perfect living master. So I am giving you just a few hints which I learned from great master. And I can tell you that when you are in the presence of a great master, perfect living master, you will feel it. You will feel maybe you have known this person for a long time. Because perfect living masters come into our life when we are ready. Ready to go home. Ready to find the truth. When we are not ready, we go through many phases. And this is not a short-term search that we just started searching in 3 months and we found it. These are lifelong searches. Sometimes takes many lives to come to a point when we are ready for that. But when we are ready, something happens to tell us this is what we were waiting for. A strange feeling comes. We are meeting a master for the first time. And we just saying a few words, we say, this is what I was waiting for all my life from childhood. There was a friend of mine. He was living in New Jersey. And then when he met me first time, he had tears in his eyes. And I didn't know why. He brought a single rose to give to me. And he presented the rose. I, considering that I am an elder person, he's a young man, I patted him on the head. Just simple, few seconds. And I took his rose with gratitude. Thank you for remembering me and bringing me a nice gift of a rose. He said, this one incident changed his life completely. He said he felt love in his life for the first time. How can that happen? Unless one is ready somewhere else, this thing can't happen so suddenly. He left everything, New Jersey, moved on to where he heard, I may be doing work to spread the teachings of Great Master in a small little town called Bruce, Wisconsin. He moved there. He bought land dedicated to the work that it'll be used only for this work of the great master. All that, one rose, one little pat on the head. It can't happen unless there is something else happening inside us and creating that. So I remember his telling after a long time and producing a photo, which I saw only several years later, that somebody took a photo of that rose being given. And he said, that incident changed my life. Such incidents by themselves are very small incidents. They're not life-changing incidents. But people, when they're ready, very small incident happen to feel they're changing their life. Something is happening. It is because of a readiness inside. It's not something from outside. Perfectly, the masters know that. And therefore, they know this is the person I've come for. They come for few people because in this show, the billions of people on this planet and so many seekers there, this is a division over time and space. That at different times, at different places on this planet, different masters appear. They appear for those people who are born at that time, are seekers, and at certain stages, and when they are ready, they pick them up. So just to make it look like more business-like, I say these are masters who come with a list in their hand. These are the names of people, these are the souls we have to pick up and take them back home. And they locate them, where are they? Okay. So somehow either they pull them there to where they are, or they go there where the seeker is, and they find the seeker and say, okay, the seeker is affected by that and falls in love. They are already in love with the seeker, and a relationship starts, which does not end till they reach their true home. Once this relationship is established, a perfect living master will never leave any seeker who is accepted by that master halfway at all. It's guaranteed. It is not based on what the seeker will do. It's not based on his meditation. It's not based on his behavior. It's not based on his life, which is all pre-written by destiny. It's based upon that love which is coming from the soul, not from the mind, not from the body, not from the senses. That love which comes from the master and the disciple, this love and the response of a disciple, which we call devotion, this love and devotion is the secret by which the master takes that person. Unlike many other teachings, they teach you how to do something. Masters don't say, we teach you how to do something. They say, we'll go together to a true home. That is why, while the experience outside is going on, and we are trying to have some good feelings, maybe master's right, and the mind is also functioning, creating some doubts and fears, which is nature of the mind. The masters keep on working in us, that the devotion, love and devotion keeps on growing. And when the time is right, we automatically remember the master, and he begins to appear in our thoughts, in our meditations. We see him, sometimes rarely, later on more frequently, ultimately daily, ultimately all the time. That astral form of the master, not the physical form. Physical form is somewhere else. The astral form of a master who initiates us, accepts us, is always with us from the time of initiation. But we don't see because we are used to seeing outside. When we are able to see inside, we discover that master is with us 24/7 always. Many things happen because of that one discovery. First thing is loneliness disappears forever. I have seen so many people complain of loneliness. And I say, when you have manifested and actually experienced the internal form, the astral form of the master, sometimes referred to as radiant form of master, inside and is steady with you, you'll never feel lonely again, ever. It's a very big thing. Everything you will do, you'll be doing with a companion with you inside. And when it's inside, just like everything is inside and sometimes appears outside, some things appear all the time outside, that's our life outside, master inside will also appear outside. Like you're driving your car and he's sitting next to you. At the corner of your eye, you can sit. He's sitting there, but he's inside. And also you are seeing him outside. I have had some very strange experiences where I thought only I could see the master. And I went to some place and somebody else opened the door and bowed to the empty space. I said, "What are you doing?" "Oh, isn't master sitting here?" I said, "You too can see." I thought I was very lucky to see him. No, some other people also begin to see. It is a great relationship. We are, master and disciple are true friends. You can define friendship in any way. True friendship, if I have found, is between a perfect living master and a disciple. A friendship that never breaks, never ends. Once it is set up, it never breaks. So when we come to find an organization, because masters sometimes set up organizations for logistical reasons only. If a master says, "Let's build a building to have our meetings," we start thinking maybe the building is itself house of God. House of God was made by God in the form of a human being, not in the form of buildings. We make the buildings. No matter what building it is, no matter what name you give to the building, they are buildings made by man. The building made by God to live in and work in and to be found is the human body within which you can find. Therefore, when a master says, "Let's have a building," he's not making a building to be a house where God lives. Just logistical reasons. So we can have meetings in a proper place which we need. Instead of running here and there, trying to find a place to have a meeting, we just have purely logistical reasons. We start falling in love with the buildings. Great master built a nice place there. And to make it, he got some designers and architects. They said, "Master, make it look nice and we'll have some minarets on the side of the building." And they put up 5 stories of stairs on that, on the sides. People began to say, "That building is the real house of God, and those stairs lead to Sachkhand, our true home." They're all trying to climb the stairs to go to their true home outside in that building. This is our nature, to see everything outside. We look for everything outside. The buildings have no importance at all. They're only for the sake of convenience. So don't attach any importance to buildings. Attach importance to the important building in which God himself lives, in our true self lives there. And discover the reality in this building, in the top floor. This is a good high floor. Actually, if you look at the building as an energetic expression of energy, then this building has 6 floors. There are the 6 chakras. They talk of the 6 energy centers. The 6 energy centers, the rectum, genitals, navel, heart, throat, eyes, the 6 centers are supposed to represent different functioning of the energy that sustain the body, that sustain our sense perception, used through the body, and make us in contact with what is around us. Makes the body work, makes us go around. Very good. They're all energy centers. When we are awake, we are automatically at the 6th center. If you consider your body to be like a house of God to be worshipped in, this is a house with 6 floors. These floors carry all energies below. The 6th floor carries energies above, which are not called energies at all. They are called awareness. Awareness is knowing yourself. Energy is using something for survival, for experience, and so on. The energy centers below, 6 energy centers, there are 12 centers of awareness above. And those centers, when you meditate and go within yourself by withdrawing your attention, you go through those centers. You're not going anywhere outside. You are going through the centers which from where you feel connected to everything that exists. It's all centered inside this body. It's the most wonderful thing. We are looking at the anatomy of the body and feeling very impressed at the physical functioning of the body. But when you look at the spiritual functioning, the functioning of other things that are happening in a smaller space, this is a big space in the whole torso of the body, but this is a small space containing a lot more. This is energy, that's awareness. Awareness has never come from down below. People are questioning me, are we at the heart center or are we at the eye center? I say, where do you feel you are? Do you feel you are at the heart or here? Are you talking to me from here or from the heart? Always from here. How did the heart center become so important? Just because they found that certain experiences in the energy centers generate an experience at the heart center where you can have an out-of-body experience. I worked with the yogis and I went through all that. And I know what the functions of these different centers are. And this is not the center of our wakeful consciousness. It's not the center where we are operating as a unit of consciousness, as a soul. The unit that works in wakeful consciousness is behind the eyes. The whole secret lies in a small space here. Go within and find out. Perfect living masters guide us, appear inside us, go with us, personally show us everything at every level. They don't send us out alone. They also take care that during spiritual exercises, we can have a lot of negative experiences. A lot of people have. When they meditate on their own, they can go into very negative territory. A lot of negative experiences also exist. Positive, negative, both are existing in the physical world as well as in astral world, as well as in the causal world. Therefore, if you are not guided properly, you can go into negative territory. People talk of heavens and hells. Do they really exist or not? In meditation, you can discover they really exist, but not in the physical plane. So sometimes people make a hell out of here also in their life, make heaven also in life. But the real places which are described are actual experiences of sensory perceptions at the astral plane. Now one can go into negative territory and have very bad experiences. That is why perfect living masters, when they accept us or initiate us, they take care that we don't go into negative territory. They tell us the ways to avoid. And when we manifest them inside, they don't allow us to go to the negative territory. So the experience remains a beautiful experience of ascending to higher and higher and better experiences. So these are some of the unique features of perfect living masters. And we should not be just carried away by anybody claiming anything. If somebody is claiming too much, he is claiming too much. He doesn't have what he's claiming. So therefore, when you are a true seeker, don't search for a master. Coincidences will bring the master to you. These are remarkable ways in which masters appear in our life. In India, they say, when a chela is ready, a guru appears. They have never said, when a disciple is ready, a master will appear. They say, people are thinking we'll find one. But the saying is, he will appear. The truth is, we search for masters and we find many teachers on our way to finding a master. But when the perfect living master comes, he appears. How does he appear? By coincidence, circumstances. Strange things happen. One thing leads to another. And suddenly we find that ordinary human being, like ourselves, just happens to be the perfect living master. Sometimes these masters not only look but behave more ordinary than ordinary people. There's no way, there's no particular sign on them to see there's a master. If people put on too many signs, that's also a red flag for me. A person putting on special kind of clothes, blue, saffron, red, any kind, to show who is an enlightened person, I'll be a little careful. I say, why do you have to show so much? I saw a number of monks once going with saffron colored robes, and I remember meeting them on the way, and I said, I am very happy to see you're wearing the right kind of robes. They said, yes, these are important robes. Without them, you can't go to heaven. That surprised me. I said, do you know why you're wearing them? Do you know the significance of the color? They didn't know. I said, look back if you find how this orange-colored, saffron-colored robe was designed to be worn by these monks. They didn't know. I said, look back at history of your own garment you are wearing. It was designed by a person to show it is the color of fire, to remind you this body will go to fire, will be burnt, cremated. Don't take it too seriously, this body. You are not only taking the body seriously, you are taking those garments also seriously, which are supposed to tell you don't even take the body seriously. So, no idea. People wear ash on their body. We are living in nature. We don't want to wear any clothes, just ash. Why ash? Why not some nice paint? No, ash because if you see the history, you put ash, this body will become ash. Don't forget that. Don't take the body seriously. Take what is inside the body seriously. Find out. These were the messages. They totally forgotten, and the ritual, the ceremony of doing outside is all important. Masters do not teach these rituals and ceremonies. They want to take us away from ritual ceremonies. Sometimes we are too much into rituals. A master comes into our life and he finds that we are following rituals taught by our family, taught by parents, taught by society. We go to temple and we do certain kind of worship. We worship little idols made up of little metal or stone or something, and we think they are gods. Some people do that. In India, a lot of people do that. And masters come and want to tell us, this is all matter, material things. Your body is better than that. This is alive. They're not even alive. They're not gods or goddesses. What you're making gods and goddesses is happening inside. Even when you're thinking of them as gods and goddesses, that thought is inside, not outside. But we still believe in them. Then what will masters do? They will come and sit with us. Yes, we also worship your gods and goddesses. We fall in love with the master. He loved the same god. I tell you a true story of my own grandmother, my mother's mother. My dad was the first follower of this great master. That was an advantage for me and a great disadvantage. Advantage was that I got to see great master very early in this life. Disadvantage was I thought I'm taking him as master only because of my father. I didn't get a chance to discover a real master. So it cut both ways. My father, once he followed this master, he married my mother, whose mother, my grandmother, followed worshipping of these little stones, gods and goddesses, with different names. And beautiful. And she would have incense burning there, she would have candles burning, beautiful temple in the house. And she would worship them and ring bells and make a music. And it was a very nice ceremony that she would do. My dad told her, this is not real. You should come and see this master. He gives you the real teaching. The real things are inside. She said, shut up and go to your master. Don't disturb my gods. You don't believe what I am believing in. Get out. You are my son-in-law, but I don't want to learn anything from you. I have lived my whole life with these gods and goddesses. So my dad told master, my mother-in-law doesn't want to believe any of this. He says, her time will come. Everybody's time comes. We go through these things. We all go through these things. We've gone for many lives. When the time comes, everything changes. And my dad said, her time will not come. She doesn't listen at all to me. He said, I'll visit her. So great master decided to visit my grandmother. When he went there, my grandmother was a little skeptical. And he said, I understand that you have a temple in the house. She said, yes, I do. May I go to your temple? He took off his shoes and went to the temple. And he said, wow, these are real gods. And he bowed to the gods, this great master. And he took the bells and began to ring the bells. My grandmother was so impressed. She said, you fool, my son-in-law, you didn't even know your own master. He believes in the same God I believe in. And the great master worshipped the gods along with my grandmother and rang the bell and lit up the candles, did everything. She was so impressed. She said, I'll come and listen to you. One little incident, one visit, made her go to great master. When she began to listen to him, she was surprised that he told the whole thing is inside. She asked for initiation, accepted. After many months, she went to master, Master, what should I do with all those gods and goddesses are sitting in my house? He said, do you have a big bag in which you get the flour, you know, a gunny bag, brown bag? He says, yes, I have a bag. Put them all in that bag, tie up the bag, and dump it in the river. Best. And she did exactly that. Can you imagine that a master, just to pick up that soul, did exactly what they were doing? His love can be expressed in so many ways. We cannot judge the way a master acts, because he acts differently for each individual. But he does find the marked souls for whom he has come and takes them home. What about so many other people who also see him? They are affected also, but they are not marked to go. So that is why, it's just my own classification, I said he carries two lists, list A and list B. List A, for whom he has come, they'll go with him this lifetime. List B, who have seen him and are marked by just seeing him, and they will also go later on with other masters. This is just my own classification. Don't give credit to him for that. I made it up. But this is how these perfect living masters operate. It's very great, the greatest good fortune I can possibly imagine, to be found by a master and to be ready to discover the truth about our own self, truth about our true home, where we belong, who we are, where the whole world comes from, whole creation comes from. It's all within us. I congratulate all of you. You are all seekers of the same truth. I and you are co-travelers on the same path. And whatever I will find, you will find. There's no question about it, because we're seeking the same thing. And we know it's all lying inside us. Thank you very much for joining me again. I'll see you next month again. See you.